sure I've ever been in a session where the crowd has called itself to order. You guys are awesome. So since everyone, yes, a hush fell over over our space here, I think we'll go ahead and get started with the panel. So this is Best Contemporary Worship Music You May Not Know, a hipster title if ever I heard one. But we've got panelists from a wide variety of denominational traditions and backgrounds, and I'm really excited about the shape our conversation is going to take today. We've been corresponding over email for the last few weeks, and a lot of great ideas represented here. So basically, how this is going to work today, we'll spend the first few minutes, 15 or 20 minutes, introducing ourselves and talking about, first off, you know, that definitions question. So what exactly do we mean by contemporary worship music? And I think based on our responses over email, that the panelists, we don't all mean the same thing when we use that term. And I think that that's okay, you know, just as long as we are clear as to what that includes and what that leaves out from the get-go. But we'll also discuss some of the criteria that we use, and then we'll spend the midsection of this session listening. You came here, I'm sure, to be inspired, to hear inspiring music. So we've got several examples. Each of our panelists has managed to narrow things down to one. They were initially asked for 10, and that was hard enough to limit it there. But each person has one song that they're going to talk about, that they're going to discuss how you know their criteria fit, how it works, and why it works in their particular context. And then in the latter part of our session today, we'll talk about processes of selection and helpful resources that exist right now, so that you can go home and use. And then ones that all of you entrepreneurial folks out there that we need, that we need someone to develop. So we'll. And then we'll leave about 20 to 30 minutes for Q&A from the floor at the end. So I think we'll start out by just a very brief introductions. You have access to all of our bios online, so we won't spend too much time with this. But we'll start at the end with David, just briefly. Who are you?
Hi, everybody. My name is David Bailey from Richmond, Virginia. I lead a ministry called Airbomb. I'm a part of a community called East End Fellowship, where we seek the joy and the justice of our community out of our love for Christ. And we are in a community that's going through the word gentrification, which means it's a historically African-American neighborhood, went through some economic depression due to legislations and things of that nature. And then a bunch of white people said, man, this is a cool place to live. And so it just changed everything. So our church, we started the church about 10 years ago and said, hey, what does it look like to be a faithful presence where, yes, economic flourishing is happening, but injustice is happening at the same time? And what does it look like for the people of God to be a faithful incarnational presence? And our worship music has been a significant part of shaping the culture, both the forming to do the work of presenting the gospel through reconciliation, proclamation, and justice, but then also through just helping them with our cross-cultural engagement.
My name is Wen Reagan. I am from Durham, North Carolina. I'm a director of worship at an Anglican church in Durham. Previously worship director at a Presbyterian church. So I've moved in a little more of a high church direction. Things are going great, I promise. They're going great. No, it's wonderful. I'm having a blast. I also write music actually with Bruce and Zach and plenty of other people here too as a part of an organization called Cardiphonia. So really enjoy doing that. And I finished my doctoral work recently in American Christianity, and I wrote on the cultural history of contemporary worship music. So trying to trace how rock and roll got in the church and all its different variations and what it's done after it got there. The good, the bad, the ugly. So, yeah, that's me.
My name is Bruce Benedict. I am the chaplain of worship arts at Hope College, which is about 30 minutes down the road towards the coast. We have an incredible basketball team for any of you that follow these sorts of things. We were here rehearsing last night with Sandra McCracken, and if you go to her Vespers, I'll just apologize because we were mostly watching the basketball game while we were rehearsing. But I help lead all the music services there and work with an incredible group of students that are leading worship this morning and then this evening in the Performing Arts Hall over here. And I also work with an organization called Cardophonia, which kind of seeks to curate and crowdsource kind of liturgical contemporary music. We do a lot of retuning of old hymns and whatnot. And then I also help oversee a Facebook group called Liturgy Fellowship, which is just sort of a safe place for worship planners to ask questions and get just really good feedback from other worship leaders and planners.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Monique Ingalls. I teach ethnomusicology and church music at Baylor. I'm kind of Baptist turned Episcopalian, so my 20s were spent as a denominational free agent, both for my research, my study contemporary worship music, similarly to Wynn, but from an anthropological perspective, and yeah, that's me.
Good afternoon, or good morning, Emmett Price, professor of music at Northeastern University, where I study both, or teach both ethnomusicology and music industry. Also professor of church and culture at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary, where I teach theology, culture, and worship. The pastor of Community of Love Christian Fellowship, which is a four-year-old church plant in the Alston neighborhood of Boston. And if you know anything about Boston, the Alston-Brighton neighborhood is the largest assembly of college students in the entire Boston area. So in that one location, students from probably about 50 to 75 colleges and universities. So we have a very interesting challenge at our church. We have a ton of musicians from New England Conservatory, from Berklee College of Music, and we have a phenomenal experience there that is really empowering and inspiring for us. And so the other thing that I do is at the Hampton Ministers Conference, I'm the director of the James Abington Church Music Academy, and there we train young undergrad and graduate students to become current and future leaders of worship. Many sojourn, and we are doing Vesper services this afternoon and Friday evening as well.
My name is Sandra Maria Van Opstal. I'm the daughter of two immigrants who traveled to the U.S. from Latin America way in the 60s. That began my sojourn and my journey as a person who is looking to follow Jesus and see how different traditions express their love to him. And so that has really, really shaped me, and I think you'll see that in our discussion. I'm the mom of one child, and he's little, so I'm exhausted. So hopefully I have some filters on today because this is being recorded. I am a worship special, or I have spent about 15 years working with InterVarsity and Urbana Missions Conference in the area of diversity, worship, reconciliation, and justice, and transitioned to be a local pastor in the Christian Reformed Church on the west side of Chicago in Humble Park. So it's a charismatic, black, brown, Pentecostal CRC church. We are seeking to figure out how to live into generational differences, ethnic differences, tradition differences, and even denominational differences as we enter into worship. So I'm excited to be here.
And I'm Zach Hicks. I'm the pastor of worship at Coral Ridge Presbyterian Church down in a place with weather a lot similar to here in Fort Lauderdale. My main role there is to oversee and plan our worship services. I also write a worship blog, zachhicks.com. It looks like zachicks.com. And then I've made a few recordings and wrestled through the question of engaging the church's history and tradition and liturgy in contemporary and rock idioms, and tried to wrestle through that in practice through recording, and in practice through working with musicians, but also in theory and reflecting on it on my blog and in other places and in my writing. And I've been enjoying doing that with several of these folks, and also a part of Liturgy Fellowship, which I hope we talk a lot about for the sake of resource sharing and things like that.
All right, well, thank you all for that. Just to start out with, so contemporary worship music, I think in part of in the churches that I've been a part of, everyone has had a slightly different idea of what songs that includes and what it doesn't. I ask people to think about kind of how they would define that for their context, and not, we don't have to each of us chime in on this one. I want to get to our you know, more substantive questions about criteria, but if you have, I think, who was it? It was Bruce that had a good kind of short, concise definition of what you meant by contemporary worship. Could you share that?
It sounds like one of the scholars. Yeah.
So what is contemporary worship music?
Contemporary worship music for me would be worship that's out of the rock idiom, that's been written in since sort of the 70s to 80s, that sort of largely comes from kind of a worship music industry.
So connections to musical style, to industry, anybody have, they'd like to?
Well, I think the challenge of the term contemporary is that it could be genre specific. It could be what we call a mashup or a remix of something. For instance, I got a little reverb here. If you take a song like, there's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. It's contemporary because it's talking about the spirit in this specific place, even though the song is old. So you could take a song and make it contemporary based on your location. So contemporary could be time, could be location, could also be the understanding of what's contemporary societal needs. So in this moment where we have so much injustice that's being promulgated based on media and social media, there could be an old song that is current and contemporary because of the times. So I'm not so sure that it has to be based on acoustic versus electric, be based on, you know, copywritten 2015 versus, you know, 2000, you know, whatever, or based on, you know, that I think there's an opportunity here for us to re-engage what this notion of contemporary is.
And I think I would add that contemporary, as it relates to traditional, generally has a cultural bias when it comes to worship. It's generally speaking about things that have come out of the white Western tradition. And it's really blurry within other traditions. I mean, I can give one example in African American tradition. I mean, the gospel music, I mean, it's just basically rock music. You know, rock music is gospel music. And we've been doing it for a very, very long time. And some of the songs we've been singing for 50, 70 years, but it's still, quote, unquote, contemporary. So I think it's a challenging term, but I think being aware of the culture in which it's speaking, it helps to understand how the term is being used.
I think when I think of contemporary, I'm thinking of, I mean, the first thing I thought of, and I'll just be honest, I wrote this, the first thing I thought of when I heard contemporary worship music is just CCM. So things that are produced by white Americans that get put on iTunes and CCLI and Song Select, and like that's kind of the industry. Like that's the first thing that popped in my mind. But when I think about contemporary, to build off what David's saying, and is that I'm thinking about what is currently happening in the people of God, and what are they writing about and are curating to express what they're going through. So whether it's a style thing where they're like, I'm tired of all the sound, like let's go back to, you know, and put the instruments in, violins and banjos and whatever, you know, or whether it's vocals and spirituals. And I know it's happening within the Latino tradition too. So it could be an old song made new, but it's really what is, when I think of contemporary, it's what is expressing people's deepest desires for God within that current moment in time, whether it's to respond to the injustice or just what they're experiencing of God in that generation.
So I thought it was a great question. And I think part of it coming back is, why do we even have to ask this question? Why is this important? And obviously it is, and it's charged ethically in some sense. It's charged liturgically. But it just tells you kind of the turmoil that goes on even in trying to define something that we're talking about. I mean, I agree with all these. I think the only thing I'd add would be, in my context, dealing with this difference between contemporary worship music and a hymn, that these are two different things. And then you have these subsets, like a retuned hymn, A contemporary hymn is something that I hear a lot in the circles I run, and what does that mean? And these are, they're worship songs, but it's really that, in some sense, doctrinally or theologically in their text, they're held higher. They're considered more esteemed in some sense, but there are biases that are kind of inherent in that too. So I think it's a great question, but I think even in asking it, we should think too of why do we even have to ask this? Like, why is it such a thing that we have a lot of feelings about? And I think that's good, but it's also important.
I think it's important that you say that, because I think the challenge is we've been driven by a music industry, yep. right, that has almost become the liturgy, right, of our ecclesiology, right? And so the challenge, I was going for another one. Everything in threes, right? But I mean, the challenge is when you don't challenge the origin of the conversation. So it's almost like we're chasing something that's absolutely irrelevant, right? Because the point is that every local congregation or parish has very specific needs for a specific time, right? Not only in the life cycle of that local congregation or local parish, but in the community and the challenges that that local church are doing. So for them, what is considered contemporary may be outdated or has been or been there, done that for another location. So we have to get out of the comparative model too, right? Because a large church versus a smaller church, they're both important. There is no comparison. They're both important. And so based on budget, right? Based on resources, right? Based on access, right? Based on information, based on technology, gives you either what is considered an advantage or a disadvantage. And I'm suggesting that that's not where the conversation should be. The conversation should be, what is the liturgy of the house, right? And how can you reinforce, influence, and inspire a continuum by which you connect generations together and make sure that the teaching of the house continues and that everybody in the house gets fed? Because you have some carnivores, you have some vegetarians, and you have some vegans, right? And everybody needs to eat, right? So it needs to be contemporary for everybody.
That was one of the things that that we talked about, that our conversation often circled around, is these issues of context and how you'll hear, I think, embodied a lot of these different definitions in the songs when we get to those. But before we start listening, I'd like to talk about criteria, because each person sent a list of excellent, if you know, slightly shaded, slightly different, differently nuanced criteria that they use in their particular context for choosing these songs. So you know, our denominational, theological tradition, demographic factors, age, race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, all of these things play into what songs are we consider good, what is good for the people that we serve and that we worship with Sunday to Sunday. So what counts as a good song, the criteria for excellence in your context? I think, Zach, you had the largest number and the most well-developed of those. All the criteria that you said. Yeah.
All right. So. These are mine. Musical excellence and authenticity, a strong engaging melody and chord structure accompanied in a way that is faithful to the musical idioms of rock and its various subgenres. And what I mean here is that as someone who is trained musically, classically, coming into the contemporary modern worship world, I wanted to see us be able to reflect deeply about the music we were making and be honest about its own musical origins and be able to almost, the way the church music degrees of yesteryear, you used to study music history because it informed the way you made music then. And I feel like for however you want to define contemporary worship music, one of the things we can do to be faithful students is to be students of the history of rock. Because what that does is it gives you greater and more helpful grids to analyze whether these songs and their basic structures, however we end up arranging them for our people, are done faithfully and well within the idiom. So musical excellence, that's one of them. Theologically sound in both text and complementary musical meaning. And for me, that's just a given. Does it comport with the message of Scripture and the whole counsel of God? But also the musical meaning behind it. I mean, you just the concept of fittingness. That does the way that this arrangement make you feel? Does it match what the text is saying? And if not, it's not good contemporary worship music, I think. Emotional fittingness and poignancy. I said great worship music of any kind should be traditional or modern or contemporary or classical, whatever, should be loaded with emotional content, which, like I was talking about, fits the spirit of the text. And I'll sometimes listen to a song and ignore the words, as weird as that sounds for like a theological diehard like me. I'll ignore the words and just ask, how does this make me feel? And then I will start to read the words and ask, do those match? Because I really believe, and it's a slightly different thing than musical meaning there, because it's does it actually grip you? Musically, does it grip you and grab your heart and do something to you? Second to the last one, or actually the last few, consonants with the grammar of the gospel. I just really care about the reformational concept of how do we approach God faithfully in worship, and that it's always through Christ. And therefore, I'm always analyzing and looking at worship music through the grid of, is this faithful to the fact that we cannot approach God by our own merit and boasting and triumph, but need to approach him through the merits of Christ. And that doesn't necessarily always mean that every song has to mention Jesus and the cross and atonement and those kinds of things. But what I do mean is, does this song give me the victory in coming to God, or does it champion Christ's victory for me? And so I think a lot about that. Liturgical placement, where does a song fit within the narrative of the story we're trying to tell in the worship service? So I'm often funneling songs based on where they fall in the liturgy, and if they don't fall anywhere, I just end up not using them. And then the final thing I'd say is momentous. There's a contextual reality when you're a local church pastor or worship leader where you might have a perfectly great song that doesn't fit the moment that you're in with your congregation, because something has happened in culture that rattles, and therefore the shiny, happy, clappy song that you were planning on introducing totally doesn't work for the next month because everybody's in the doldrums of grief and they need something else. So that often is my kind of final pastoral criterion.
This is such a hard question. I mean, I'm sure all of you deal with this every week when you're thinking about what songs are good. For me, it's really a question of interpretation. Can the song be faithfully reinterpreted? Right? So every time you have a song, whether it's in a score or recording, you have to interpret it into your church. You have to pull it out and translate it to your context. And so can this song be faithfully, pastorally reinterpreted into my context? Often that's a liturgical context. So where does it fit in the liturgy? How is it serving the liturgy? In that sense, how is it serving the people and the work they're doing, right, in worshiping God? I also think about, in terms of music, to Zach's point too, does it fit with the contours of Scripture, and particularly with the Psalms? So the emotional bandwidth that we have in the Psalms, right? The Psalms provide this large emotional bandwidth. We have joy, we have sorrow, and everything in between. We have honesty. Sometimes we call God out on things and say, come and fulfill your promises that you've promised us. And so I think that's important too. In fact, and a little vignette on that. So was writing an article with a friend who studies prosperity theology and is a historian, does some ethnographic work.
It's such a good article. Tell them what the article is.
Oh, thanks. So it's an article on worship music, contemporary worship music in prosperity gospel tradition. How prosperity gospel and contemporary worship music interacts, particularly textually, but also musically. And so my friend Kate was doing some ethnographic research down with Joel Osteen at his church, Lakewood in Houston, and she went to the Good Friday service. And the juxtaposition of what happened there, and this is not to hit on anyone, but the sense of this church that is so dedicated to joyfulness at all times, is so dedicated to God's power in your life to help you succeed, to help you overcome whatever's going on. A wonderful message in that sense. But on Good Friday, not the story. And so what happened was this, they couldn't sit in Good Friday. They couldn't sit in sorrow. They couldn't sit in this moment of loss. So the service had this very bizarre juxtaposition where they were still joyful, and it didn't work. And so she was really struck by this, and that's kind of what kind of moved us to start looking at this article and doing some research there. But just to encourage in that sense, that emotional bandwidth, like have songs, for me, that's what, for me, have an emotional bandwidth that is able to touch all the different aspects of life, and in that sense is honest.
What's the title of that article? I really care about it.
I don't remember. It'll come back to me in a second.
Side note, so this panel I think is somewhat based off of actually an article, speaking of articles, that Wynn wrote called... Yeah, and so you're the one that started this contemporary thing. So yeah, you can finish that. I think sometimes just this question is a classic example of how, as worship planners and leaders, we sort of live in the tyranny of the urgent of like, what's the next song? And a couple of years ago, I was like, you know what? I don't actually know what's happening with my whole song catalog. So I actually spent a couple of weeks doing a survey of my whole repertoire. So I kind of like sat down and I took all the songs that our church would did in the last 3 years. And I looked, okay, I want to look and see, you know, like, because you have this perception of the songs you do a lot, that it's always wrong, always. Yeah. And so we went in and I looked at, okay, what are the top 25 to 50 songs our church does? And then I looked at those like top 25 to 50 songs and I thought, okay, well, let's see, I've got some songs about this and this and no songs at all. I don't have any songs in the Psalms. Holy cow. Didn't realize that. You know, so I think sometimes we really need to step back and spend some time looking at all the songs that we do to really kind of to make better choices about what the next song is going to be. I think one of the biggest things with songs is trying to pick songs that fit really significant needs. And you guys have mentioned it, you know, songs that kind of speak to the whole emotional breadth. You know, and that often, but you have to know what that is.
Yep.
You have to know what are the songs that your congregation really needs. And like, I often get annoyed when people say, oh gosh, you know, that song, it's only gonna last for a week. That's a throwaway song. You know, we won't sing that song in 2 months. And I'm like, yeah, but that's okay. If it's a song that fits perfectly your pastoral moment. You know, most of our pastor's sermons are really they're words from God for a particular time and a moment. And I think as people choosing songs, we need to be okay with songs serving particular moments and not necessarily being that concerned if they're going to last forever.
And I think just to kind of inject into the conversation the issue of resources, something that I've faced as someone who's been attending small churches for the last probably 6 to 7 years. The largest church I've attended is about 120 on a Sunday. One small parish that met every 2 weeks when I was living in England had 12, you know, regular attenders. And one organist who was there some of the time, sometimes not. A cappella with 12 people in a large resonant space could be fun. But we need, sometimes, as a criteria, songs that can be performed excellently given limited musical resources. I mean, I certainly, you know, I think most of what we've been speaking to are, you know, if assuming that our bands or our instrumentalists, our singers can perform just anything, that we have the wide, we can pull off the wide emotional gamut. I think that's something that I've been confronted, and maybe others of our panelists have been confronted with, when our ideal for I'd love to sing this song this Sunday, it goes perfectly, perfect place in the liturgy, or it goes perfectly with the pastor's message, but can we perform it excellently, either as you know, worship team or choir, or as a congregation? I think that can be a struggle. So that we get a chance to listen to our music, I think I'm going to transition us into that. I've had each of the panelists, again, they were initially commissioned to suggest 10 songs. We've narrowed that down to one. I'll bring up YouTube clips. We'll listen through to the verse and chorus of each of them, and then like to invite each of the panelists to speak to just how this song, what is it about this song that made you choose it? How does it work in your context? And I think just for ease, we'll start at this end with David's song. Tell us a little bit about Purge Me.
Well, I'm actually let me do Passover song.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I have it on my phone. But so we started this songwriting internship program about 5 years ago. And when we started this song, I mean, when we started this internship, the church was probably about 100, 120 people. And I think one thing that happens in a lot of churches is that we just set our worship standards to the lowest common denominator versus, you know, having a high standard. And when you set it to a lowest common denominator, real musicians don't really want to be a part of it. And so when you kind of set a higher standard, and then it just really helps to people to want to be a part of something great. And so this doesn't necessarily mean that it has to be hard to sing or necessarily hard to play, and it shouldn't mean that. So when we try to do our music, we try to make sure the melody is something that people can sing, but the music that goes around it to make sure it's interesting. Does everybody understand that? So we commissioned songs because for our context, being like economically diverse, racially and ethnically diverse, there just wasn't a lot of stuff. So I would spend time on, you know, these websites and getting stuff from Cardiophonia and maybe rearranging it. But even some of the pastoral issues weren't necessarily being written from the context in which we had. So something we really started to, our standards was theologically sound, but didn't necessarily mean theologically dense. And that's a very different thing. And I think a lot of times when you're theologically dense, you're playing a bias towards educated people. And so it's important to not think that theologically sound means theologically dense. It could be a simple thing that's sound. We try to write something that's not, the Bible's super huge. And you realize there's just not a lot of stuff that's written about. And so we literally will pick like Exodus or Acts and just go through that and write through the book of Exodus or Acts. And it just really, that limitation leads to some significant innovations. We definitely try to be Trinitarian and really don't forget about the Holy Spirit's work in this, and that's a really significant thing. And so this one song that's going to be on the next Urban Doxology album is called the Passover Song. And we realized that we don't do a lot of narrative. Like, there's also a bias towards Western syllogisms, and most of the world doesn't think in that way. Most of us think in a narrative. And so whether you have a PhD or you're 5 years old, you can remember a really, really great story. And the majority of the Bible was written in the context of a story. So this song was written by the piano player that will be in the worship service tomorrow. And he is talking about the Passover, and just really each verse is part of that narrative. And so I'm going to play that for you.
Today my sins are
So a lot of times we produce the music. We try not to make sure it sounds like Christian music, you know? And that's just like, we kind of have the roll the window down test, you know? Like we roll the window, you don't know what the words are being said, and it sounds like regular music that everybody else listens to. And, but we also really intentional about fusion genres. If you listen to the end of it, like it kind of, surprisingly, but I think tastefully kind of goes to like a gospel feel ending, you know? And so we try to think about who's in our church and try to have a little, what I'm looking for, kind of like something for people to grab on in different spaces.
Fantastic. And when you speak about your song or beforehand, could you tell us a little more about Cardiophonia?
Yeah, sure.
David, where do we find your music?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Oh, go on Urban Doxology. UrbanDoxology.bandcamp. And our site is going through maintenance. I think you could probably get on the newsletter. The new album's coming out in February. So that song will be on there.
.bandcamp. Like we're going to camp, but it's Bandcamp. Yeah. So Cardiophonia. So Cardiophonia, as Bruce said, it's his brainchild. And he's adopted us as part of this large motley crew of musicians, songwriters, worship leaders around the country. And I know actually plenty of you in the audience are part of this. And so crowdsourcing is kind of the way you've described it. So we often will take an idea for an album, let's say Pentecost Sunday, let's say Songs for the Table, things like that. And Bruce will often pass around some old text that have been forgotten and see if some of us want to put them to new music and also invite us to write new songs for the theme for the album. So we end up doing, like two a year, yeah. And they're usually released for free on Bandcamp, or at least to start, we take donations for different charity organizations, and then we release them for free to the church. And we hope that people get to use them and that they're useful. So the song I want to talk about is called Alas, not My Savior, Please, where is it? Alas the Lord, My Life Is Gone. You can tell I've spent so much time with this song that I remember its title. This is a great song. It's actually, it's based on the canticle in Jonah 2, to which you should immediately say, who writes a song from Jonah 2? And Carl Diggerness and Brian Murphy actually decided to do that. So number one, this is why I love this song, because no one writes from this text, and it's great that they do. So text-wise, it's really a Christological reading. It's looking at Jonah and seeing Christ in it and trying to kind of unearth and dig into the text to reveal Christ. Musically, it's very simple. The melody is very simple. It's very singable. Beautiful melody, beautiful arrangement. And the text in Jonah, even with the Christological reading, I just love it because it's very honest. It does call God to account, to stick with his promises that he's given to us in Jesus. So I guess we can listen to a little bit of it. Come on, Bandcamp. I also have it on my phone if needed.
Okay. If I could get a tech support person, if there's somebody in the room, I think this was wired in.
Here.
Computer was.
I've got it pulled up. So just plug this in.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Is it coming through at all? All right, here, let's do this. Unplug this. Unplug that right here. And let's just see if we can play it. I'll play it through the microphone.
Through the microphone, good idea.
Going old school.
Alas, the Lord, my life is gone. The Savior hides his face. Dark wilderness,
that's a little sample. And the song's actually fairly short, so it actually works really well for a short liturgical song. I mean, if you've got spots possibly for, I don't know, it could fit for a gradual even, if the text for the day is kind of oriented around the themes or even that text itself. So it's very maneuverable, I think, in the liturgy.
Next is Bruce with "O God of Our Salvation," and you've got a couple of different versions here.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
So there's a liturgical scholarly historian named Lester Ruth that a lot of us have learned from. And a couple of years ago, he started writing, looking at analyzing the Trinity in contemporary modern worship, and he was doing these surveys, looking at these, you know, kind of the top CCLI songs for the past 10 or 15 years. And he discovered that there were very few instances where the Trinity was mentioned. And he, you know, he even would go as far to say, kind of evocatively, I don't know that that kind of American Christianity is Trinitarian. You know, how much do we look to our worship music to sort of reflect the theologies that we actually have? And so a lot of people started writing songs based on the Trinity. And this is one that I think is particularly powerful. It's a great song. I've sung it in a number of different contexts. So I've actually got two different versions. I have kind of a really rocking modern rock version, and I have more of a Rich Mullins version. I'll let you choose. Which version do you want to hear? Both, yeah. So you guys can look it up online later, but I heard Rich Mullins first, so that's this one, the Matt Boswell version. Son and the Holy Spirit, and then the chorus has a really nice Trinitarian doxology.
Works great as a closing song. We use it a lot as kind of a closing sending song.
Yeah, fantastic. Thanks, Bruce. For the song that I chose, and I wanted to also show you a resource while I was on here. So being, having been and in the Anglican / Episcopal tradition for the past 7 or 8 years, when I lived in Toronto, I was asked to provide contemporary music for this new service, and trying to find things that fit particular liturgical times of year, especially 6 or 7 years ago, when there's been a lot more written, I feel like, a lot more written that has come into kind of mainstream consciousness on Lent, Advent, some of the seasons of the Christian year. One of the resources that that I discovered during that time, not that it was necessarily hidden, was the Catholic contemporary music. So Catholic contemporary music, I think, gets a bad rap. I mean, I think we think of, you know, kind of cheesy folk music, you know, 70s style folk music, but there's a wide variety of Catholic contemporary music, and especially if you get up on Spirit and Song, their website, they've got resources, you know, browsing by songs and artists, and there's also a section where you can browse by, and I think they list several seasons of the year, so they've got a Lent playlist, for instance, that you can go through. And one of the artists, so many of you have probably heard of Matt Marr, Audrey Assad, some of these Catholic contemporary songwriters have worked with more established folks in the contemporary Christian music industry and have gotten their songs popularized that way. But for the ones that aren't as popular, and sometimes aren't as popular because they're, you know, perhaps more specific to a season, to a time of year, have slightly different theology that reflects Catholic belief and traditions. You can get up and see this. One of my new favorites, Sarah Hart, who's a singer-songwriter, Catholic singer-songwriter in Nashville. She writes both kind of testimony music for listening and congregational music. This is a wonderful song off of her album Above Earth's Lamentation, and you can see Spirit and Song has this nice framework. You know, you can see the entire album, you can listen to the song. There are all of these accompaniment package, you know, guitar, vocal, lead sheet, downloads and things. So I'll leave the lyrics up so that you can look at them as we listen. But what I like about this song, and to continue what kind of what I was saying about the setting with limited resources, it's got you know, this great kind of folk-like pentatonic melody. It's a limited range, you know, so is very singable, perhaps, you know, transposed to a different key. Straightforward rhythms, relatively simple chords. You know, the guitarists at my church can play through this one. Lyrics are well-crafted yet simple. There are parallels, you know, what hope, what peace, what joy we have. This makes for easy recollection, I think. And I love the last line. We won't get to this point in the song, but the, and we shall live sinners and we will rise to saints. I like songs that have have an emphatic ending that stays with you. So we'll listen to this really meditation on the power of the resurrection. Starting from the beginning.
Yeah.
Testimony is more important. Todd Devaney was a former major league baseball player, played professional baseball for 5 years, and out of that vessel comes this powerful testimony. We have a tendency to focus so much on the musicality, on the instrumentation, and on the range. I believe that there should be some space for congregational worship, where the congregation is the choir, where they're not the audience, where they're not being performed to, or as I like to say, being performed at, where there is a space and a place for them to be a part of the experience or the engagement of God, which we call worship. And so this also does for me the we and the he, right? So it's not about I, and we're supposed to associate with your eye, my eye, your eye, your eye, because our eyes don't match, right? But the we is why we collectively come to engage in a meaningful and powerful transformative experience with the God who we serve. It's the we, right? Otherwise, we would listen to this in our car, and we listen to this in our shower, and we're all good shower singers, I know, amen. Right? But there's something powerful when we bring the we together. So for me, this came out May 2015, so it's not so much new, but I think it's powerful, and I think it's potent, and it's transformative. So that's the other thing, if I can say, the other selections that I had were not available, which is the other tension here, that the things that we selected are all commercially available, right? So there's one that's on YouTube, and if you have a pencil and paper, I just invite you to write it down. One of my dear friends, Dr. Diane White Clayton, who's a phenomenal composer, musician, who goes to Faithful Central. She's part of the ministry of Faithful Central Church in Los Angeles. She went to a essentially a practice room. Yeah, this is her. Can we do that?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I didn't
mean
to cut you off.
For herself. Yes.
But Lord, your enemies do what is good.
Tells a story about having just come out of service, and her pastor was preaching a convicting sermon on the fact that we need to love our enemies. And as creative people, she did exactly what many of us do. She went to the piano, and you can see her work. She put her Bible, took the scripture. She has her notes there. She has a manuscript paper. And this is her actually recording herself writing a composition in real time about love your enemies. That messed me up.
So,
I need a moment after those two songs. I almost got lost in the first one, and I really appreciated the second one because it leads into what I was going to say. So I was going to share a different one and talk about we, but since he just did that, let me share my second choice and ask, first of all, could you raise your hand if you are a woman worship leader in this room? If you're a female and you lead worship. Okay, nice and high. Y'all know it's really hard to find songs, okay? It's really hard to find songs. So if you are a woman and you are a worshiper, raise your hand. If you're a woman and you worship in your church, you're a congregant and you sing in your church, okay? You sing in your church, all right. You all know it's hard to sing the songs that people pick for us. So let me start, because they spoke so much about the other criteria I had written down, by saying that songs have to be singable to the whole congregation. So turn to your neighbor and say, the whole congregation. So when I put this list of criteria down, in my book, I specifically put it must be singable. You must choose songs and keys that are melodically simple and singable to the whole congregation. So I used to wonder why, when I would go to, I worked for 15 years with students, a lot of Asian American students, African American, Latino students, and I used to wonder when I would go worship with the Asian American students why all the women knew how to sing harmony. Like, how is it that they all know how to sing harmony? And then I found out that never was there an Asian American female worship leader in their churches, which meant that the melody was always so high that the only thing you could do is come up underneath it and support that, okay? So, if you go to CCLI Song Select, even if you go to famous gospel artists, even if you go to black gospel churches, you're gonna find songs that were written by men from their experience as men in keys that are singable by men. So I think it's important, given the statistics in our church, that we really make hospitable places for everyone in our congregation. So I'm gonna share a song with you that was written by a friend of mine. Her name is Melissa Vallejo. You can find her on iTunes. Her last name is spelled V-A-L-L-E-J-O, V-A-L-L-E-J-O. She's a bilingual Puerto Rican woman who writes songs as a person who is bilingual. So if you're Spanish speaking, you might think, well, that Spanish is not that great. And if you're English speaking, you might be like, well, that's not really grammatically correct. Thus is the experience of a bilingual second generation person. So here's a song she wrote out of her own experience and testimony. And I actually want to hear the song without the words. Can we take the words off? Because I want to go to what Zach said. And I want you to see if you can tell what the song says if you don't speak Spanish by the way the song feels. Because of this, I give you all of me. I give you all I have.
and now I sing, and now I dance, and now I jump, and it's all for you.
Right? Yeah. She's also primarily a percussionist, so did you feel that? She's one of the best Latin percussionists in the, she's in Orlando if you guys want to find her, but so she wrote out of her experience and out of also her strengths. And I think that songs that are coming out of our experience and are hospitable to the whole church, whether that's gender, ethnic diversity, age, generation, I think it's important for us to think about what we think is good may not be what someone else in the congregation thinks is good, which I think is why worship committees are really important. And I think it's singable in the sense that it's easy and it's catchy and people catch on to it. We do this a lot in places where there are not Spanish speakers and people catch on really quickly.
Yeah, I use it too. I want to say, Sandra just has a book that just came out and it's really awesome. So make sure that you go on Amazon and buy it. It's called Next Worship.
One of the things I wanted to point out that I love about the songs that I heard, which needs to be said for those of us who are church musicians, that we need to be decent musicians in what we do. Because here's the reason. All the songs that I heard actually are pretty flexible. Like you can almost break them down to melody and chord structure and rearrange them well, but you need to be a musician with good musical sensibilities to do that. And it actually is a pastoral motivation why you would do that, you know? Or change the range. Or do anything that those require, but some of us need to be able to attain those skills and that education for the sake of our churches being a more hospitable environment. Because what I loved about what I heard was that I could hear us at Coral Ridge doing it in our context with our rock band and pipe organ, you know, together in a totally different way, but in a way that made, and that flexibility is marvelous. That's one of the reasons I chose this song. I chose it as kind of representative of a kind of group of music that's got its niche, but it's out there, and I call it the Mars Hill diaspora, because Mars Hill things like exploded over there and happened. And one of the things, honestly, that I was grieving most about what happened at Mars Hill in Seattle was that this wonderful, new, fresh, music-making group of people and musicians and artists got disbanded, sort of. I'm grateful that I'm seeing them come alive, but they're groups like Ghost Ship and Modern Post, Dustin Kensrue, Citizens and Saints. And it's not all encompassing, it's a particular kind of genre, but the lyrics that they write are great. And they're flexible. And the other thing that I love about them in particular is that as a songwriter, it's always harder to write a fast song that is good. You know, there's lots of bad, fast, up-tempo songs out there. And there are very few that are good. And to your point about the difficulty with the fast song is if you want to be theologically sound, you can't have a lot of words, right? Because it's going by fast and the syllables are moving quickly. And so I just feel like for the sake of the emotional excitement, songwriters who write fast music tend to just be sloppy about what they say. And here's an example of a song that's fast and vigorous and full of wonderful meaning and depth, and then saying a few things that I think are worth saying, which is why I want to hear it, and then I'll talk about it.
Yeah. Come and stand before your maker. Full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence.
So there are many things that I love about this song. I do think it's flexible. I think you can take it, because the melody is pretty simple and it's repetitive, you can take in a lot of different range and stylistic expressions, which I really like. But one of the key things it does, which a lot of opening songs don't do on the front end, is acknowledge suffering and the sufferer. It says, and acknowledge some issues that are just very present in our global reality today. It says in verse 2, we are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness. You started making me cry, so I'm going to start crying. Bought with sacrificial blood, bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a father who will never let them go. I mean, that's a killer line. And to be able to sing that in your community on the front end of worship, to prepare yourself to hear that reconciling word about Christ in the gospel. And then verse 3, which... what I love about it is it tethers our suffering into the suffering of Christ. Again, right at the beginning of the service, which I think is always the tricky part about being honest people when we're starting a service and have this wonderfully loud, wonderful, vast song of thanksgiving, is there's all various degrees of suffering in this room. I think every one of us would say, right now I'm suffering somehow. And it always feels a little bit not genuine when I'm just coming in, even though it's to enter his gates with thanksgiving, but I'm thanking him through the sorrow. And what I love about this third line is, all our sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still, turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. And then a change in the chorus that sings, rejoice. When you cry to him, he hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice, in the midst of suffering, he will help you sing.
It's like a beatitude.
Oh, it's a, yeah. And what I love about that is it also puts Jesus in the room with us and says he's worshiping with you, and the one who went to the cross has got his arms wrapped around you, and you can suffer, and he knows right what you're doing. He knows right where you're at, and he's suffering and singing with you. And it's just, So we sing this a lot at Coral Ridge, and it blesses my heart, blesses my soul, and it blesses our congregation, and we often have moments where we will bust open our huge multi-million-dollar pipe organ and just melt faces, and it's just incredible.
Yes.
Fantastic. So, well, I'm tempted, if we had all day, to go around and around and around and talk about even more songs. We'll have a resource that we'll make available online with these resources, as well as several of the others. Like I said, we started out with 70 songs and narrowed them down to these. So let's talk a little bit more. We've talked throughout a bit about the process of selection and some of the helpful resources that there are, where we go to find songs. Let's dig a little bit deeper into that. And if there's something that's easy to find, I'm happy to run up and show everybody find the link online. So I think a couple of things that came up several times, the Multicultural Worship Leaders Network, Cardiphonia, some of these resources. We have some speak to that. Bruce, could you talk a little bit more about Cardiphonia and the range of resources there, and I can pull that up online.
Yeah. So when I, out of seminary, right, I'm going to a church that was in downtown Indianapolis. And when I got there, they had four different worship teams doing a totally different style of worship every Sunday. One week was like Brooklyn Tabernacle, one week was bluegrass. And so I just kind of fell into this world that most of us actually live in now, of just eclectic music. You know, you're trying to find all sorts of different things. You have congregations that listen to everything. And so how do you just curate and put resources together? And as I was just talking to worship leaders, I kept finding, people are listening through 1,000 albums trying to find one song for like sort of specific purposes, right? So a song for communion, a song for Pentecost, a song for the season of Lent. And worship leaders just needed like albums that actually were just thematically tied together. Even if they weren't gonna like choose a song from a theme, they at least had some ideas to work off of. So Cardiphonia just started as a way to really put worship albums together for worship leaders. Around themes that people were telling me they needed. So we just started kind of from the beginning. We did one for the Apostles' Creed. We did one for Communion, Pentecost, the season of Ascension, right? I mean, You don't have Pentecost unless you can celebrate Christ's ascending. But we couldn't find any songs for that. And we've just sort of kind of like, are just sort of meandering our way around. We did a really fantastic project where we took all of the biblical canticles, right? The actual songs of scripture, you know, besides the Psalms. I'm like, okay, so, you know, as worship leaders, we should have some songs from the Bible songs. If you're in a heavily liturgical tradition, right, you'll have a lot of different settings of the canticles. But if you're in a kind of blended or contemporary setting, no way. Maybe you've got Aaron Keyes has a good Song of Moses, you know. So one of the canticles was just great, and then we just did one for Christmas that was just 25 texts for the season of Advent and Christmas that actually doesn't contain any Christmas songs you've ever heard of. Because, you know, after a while you have like 50 different versions of O Come, O Come, and you kind of have an idea of what, you know, you're gonna do with it. But so that's a little bit about Cardiffonia.
David, would you like to speak more about Erebon and other ministries like it?
Yeah, so can't speak too much to other ministries like it because I don't really know that many of them. But so we do this urban songwriting internship program, and applications are going to be open, I think, this Friday. But we get really gifted musicians, singers, some are songwriters. Everybody doesn't necessarily have to be a songwriter. And for 8 weeks, we are training with theology, urban ministry, contextualization, reconciliation, and they're writing songs. Instead of writing a paper, they're writing songs. And a lot of this is we choose a theme that we're going to do for the next week, maybe not the next week, next year for our church. And so it's the best thing that anyone could ever do. And I say this because I'm not any longer in the week-to-week worship leading thing, but I think all of y'all can relate to the summertime being the worst time to be a worship leader, right? Because everybody goes on vacation, somebody's out of town, you're always trying to figure out stuff, and you got to fill in these gaps. Well, for us, because of this internship program, that's the best time musically for our church. Because we got gifted musicians that are here. It's a farming system. So at our church, out of 300 people, we have 50 people who are part of the worship ministry, and like 10 of them are professional musicians because of the cultural creativity that's happening in our community. And so anybody can do it. It's not like a patent thing. And I would really encourage you all to commission, whether you do an internship program or whatever the case would be, set aside some of your budget to cultivate artists to write music. I'm of a philosophy that I think when it says in Colossians to let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, Nashville didn't exist at the time. There wasn't a Christian media industry, right? So I think every local church needs to have, I think there needs to be a common canon that we all sing. It's helpful if I go to visit any of your churches, I could grab onto something. But I also don't feel like I should go to your church and know every single song. Like, I feel like there's something specific to your church, and what is God speaking to your community, your church? And it's kind of like reading the New Testament as a whole, or getting in to read the particularities of the particular letters. A good, healthy, theological, robust Christian knows how to see the whole and see the part. And I think we learn from the parts and the whole.
Resources to highlight.
Yeah, I'll talk about the Facebook group that Bruce moderates and that I moderate. It's called Liturgy Fellowship. If we see you guys requesting it today, we'll probably try to approve that request. It was getting unwieldy. One of the things I like about Liturgy Fellowship is it does the curation for you via the community. So this is a common post that happens at least twice a week, it feels like. I need a song on X, and you will get 50 suggestions. And it's very specific, and people will explain their suggestions, and it's usually thoughtful, musically inclined group of people that know what they're doing. And then you'll get lots of people posting, oh, there it is. There you go. Yeah. And it's helpful. It definitely caters to churches that are usually engaging in more liturgical contexts. But stylistically, within kind of the realm we're talking about, for the most part, it's all over the map. It'll be anything from folk stuff to rock stuff to pretty stylistically niched stuff. Anything you guys want to add about Liturgy Fellowship at all?
It's awesome.
Yeah. It's just one of those where you can crowdsource, and generally you're going to get a lot of helpful answers. There are a few trolls that we have to kind of, you know, put down and all that stuff when people start wanting to bash contemporary worship or traditional worship or whatever. But for the most part, it's a really ironic group of people who are out for the edification of the church in various ways. So pretty neat.
Absolutely, and I just add to, I mean, here's an example of one of the questions, you know, drawing from, you know, someone asking a question about their particular context and getting a lot of helpful feedback. Are there, while my Facebook account is up, any other groups, any groups that anybody wants to talk about?
I'll go ahead and talk about the multicultural worship leaders network.
Yep.
It's a Facebook group, yeah.
Yay! Adam's baby.
Everyone's always happy when you see a baby picture. So, I think that there has to be a lot of intentionality in looking for resources when you are in settings that are intergenerational or cross-cultural, ethnically. Because most of the sites that are curated for a particular genre, even if it's like many genres within gospel, it's still like, it's probably gonna be in a particular setting. And context is important, context is important, context is important. So one of the things I do is just hang out with other leaders. So this is one of the places I hang out with other leaders. David's on this, a bunch of folks that have been on my teams are on this. I don't know, it's like 300 or 400 people. And then when you put up, for example, we're gonna do a sermon series on the Holy Spirit, and I'm looking for songs about the Holy Spirit from different types of genres and churches, because my church is multi-ethnic, and it's intergenerational, and it's socioeconomically diverse. So therefore, I need to have songs that are kind of, so I put it on here. And then inevitably, I still am lacking particular songs. So I want to say that it is so important for you to build relationships with people who are other worship pastors in your context, wherever that is. Like if it's in your city, if it's in your denomination, who are different than you, so that you can ask them. So I have a list of leaders that I email out to. It's about 30. David's on that. And I email it out and I say, hey, I'm going to do a sermon series for the next 8 weeks on this topic. What worship songs would you suggest? And then I get them all, and then I put them in a spreadsheet. I wish I was entrepreneurial. I have nothing on the web, okay? But I have probably dozens and dozens of spreadsheets where I've curated songs from traditional hymns to modern CCM, gospel, Latino songs you'd never find out. They're African songs that are not on YouTube. And I put them all in the thing, and then I give them to the worship team and say, here's a list of 80 songs on the Holy Spirit. You know, how do you want to sort through this? Which one do you think would work for our congregation? So I think while social media is important, I think relationships are very important. And we need to be intentional in our relationships in our cities and in our denominations with people who are different than us, whatever that means in your context, whether it's generational. One of the other reasons I think this helps is because recently, I'm leading worship for this Lausanne gathering, and they said to me, let's sing a song we all know. And every time somebody says that to me, I think of my Puerto Rican and Black staff in my seminary when I brought them to a conference and everyone stood up and sang the doxology. And I mean, they were like, everybody's singing. I don't know what this is. Or at another conference when someone stood up and sang a spiritual and everyone who wasn't from that tradition was like, I don't know what this is. So I think that the way that I can figure out what is a song we all sing, so a common canon is by interacting with people from different ethnic and denominational traditions and asking, what hymns do you sing in your church? And Amazing Grace is sung by everybody in every language, in every style, in every church. So then if someone says, let's sing a song we all know, I know of the 1,200 hymns that are out there, probably Amazing Grace people will know, or Holy, Holy, Holy. So I think these networks of people on social media are awesome, and we should get them, but I just want to stress that I think your best resource is building relationships, because then you go to these sites and you pick a Spanish song, and people like me are like, nobody's singing that song. Like, nobody sings that song. Where did you get that from? From this list that somebody put up. Who put it up? Somebody that's not from that tradition. So I think it's really important to have relationships. So I just want to stress that before we keep talking about social media and technology.
Can I ask you two things for local? I mean, one thing that we do is, in our city, we host a breakfast where we just get together and talk shop with other worship leaders. And I also do it for pastors, too. It's a wonderful way of not having to be the person to resource it all yourself and to get to know different people. So I would encourage you to do that in your city. I also want to encourage you to, or your town, wherever you live, I also want to encourage you to, there are people that want to be a part of the worship ministry that can't sing or play music, and they don't need to be a part of the worship ministry when it comes to singing and playing music. But they might love to research stuff. So I get people like that. I'm not a researcher. And so I get them to like listen through all of the songs and songs they think are great songs, and you know, I get them to help maybe do hospitality or just, I mean, it's all kinds of stuff that requires to do worship ministry that is not musical or doesn't require a certain level of skill, and get those people to work in your community.
There, for those of us who use sheet music, GIA Publications has a host of phenomenal series. So there is the Catholic, traditional Catholic series, but there's also a series on African American music and Latino American music, Taizé worship, and there's a whole series. J.W. Pepper has a phenomenal aggregation of music as well. Choralnet.com. I think it's com.org has a phenomenal discussion board where there's these conversations going on. So if you're not on Facebook or not on Twitter or not mining YouTube, there are some other areas that you can go to. Let me say something that is going to be a little bit contradictory to what others have said. I absolutely disagree that people who can't sing, I think they should be in your worship ministry. I think people who can't play instruments should be in your worship ministry too. I often teach that the reason that some people are quote unquote tone deaf is because we spend all of our lives talking and they haven't spent a whole lot of time singing. And so the difference between those who quote unquote can sing and can't sing, depending on what your aesthetics are and how you judge that, is number of hours accumulated doing such. And so how do you get somebody who's not a singer to become a singer? You allow them to sing, right? So let's not, because again, when we talk about justice, it can't be financial justice and it can't be social justice. And we talk about being an inclusive body, but only the singers can sing. I mean, do you get it? I mean, so we gotta be careful. Now there's a place and a role. Yeah, don't put the mic in front of them. Right? And get you a set of congas or bongos or a djembe drum and put it in the back. Put it next to the drummer. But you have to allow people to feel the presence of God and to utilize what they feel that they're called to give so they can grow, right? And so the challenge is we kind of do the, you know, plug and play thing, right? So we'll hire the worship leader who has 5 CDs because they're tried and tested, right? And we all have musicians in our congregations. We have musicians who are either retired musicians or used to play 20 years ago and don't play anymore. You should pull them back out and have a special Sunday or a special service where somebody different can play on the piano. And you will not imagine what that does for them. I mean, it's absolutely serious, because we always think that witnessing is going outside the church. We got some folks inside the church who need to be witnessed to, right, who come as a social commitment, right? And we want them to come and eventually transform into, you know, you know that whole story. I think the other piece is this, that, and we've talked about, and we have a tendency to be musical elitist, right? Though, particularly those of us musicians, I don't like that. Mm-mm, that's in the wrong key. Yo, let it ride. You know what I mean? Because some of the most transformative moments is when the music does not work. And I'm telling you from personal experience, when you know that you have not given God your best, it's a transformative moment. And instead of trying to hide behind it and making excuses, that's the perfect opportunity to repent and to kind of readjust towards excellence, right? So in those moments where we have ministry failures, and we don't like to talk about that, and when selections just don't work, right? Those are the perfect opportunities to do a forensic audit of what happened and to say, you know what, my heart was in the right place and I thought I was gonna get up here and do three services on 2 hours of sleep and five things of coffee, and God deserves better than that. And that's your moment to actually repent and ask for forgiveness, because we get on autopilot sometimes. You know, we're 2 weeks ahead of the service, we plan three, you know, you got a season coming up in 2 months and we figure it out, and you have something like Ferguson happens. But your service was already programmed. And you don't have any flexibility in that to change up. And the last I heard, silence was a part of music, because we got these things called rest. So sometimes we need to go quiet. And longer than, let's take a moment of silence. Okay, now, right? Right, and part of that is the challenge too. So some, and the last thing, and then I'm done. Sometimes the music that you're looking for is in your congregation. And Sandra said it, I mean, if you're looking for a song that's in Spanish and your Spanish is messed up, but you're the worship leader and you're supposed to lead this Sunday, you should probably yield that to somebody who speaks Spanish and who knows the content and the context, right? Even if they do what I call the Kirk Franklin, right? And this is not disparaging to Kirk Franklin, but Kirk Franklin would talk the words and then have you respond by singing. So again, that's somebody who may not be as musical, but they can give you the right, you know, dialect, they can give you the right phrasing, right? And they can talk it so that you can feel it, and then we can respond. So don't forget that the most important, most valuable people are already in your congregation. God always sends us who we need. And it's our responsibility to have the relationships to sense who's in our congregation. Because we're always trying to hire people, and we actually have some really good people in our congregation.
And just one more thing very quickly before we open things up to Q&A. Just looking to the future, what resources still need to be developed? Any ideas about what would be particularly helpful to you all in your context related to choosing, you know, selecting good contemporary worship songs?
I mean, given the growth of the church and the future demographics of our church, I think more resources are needed to both curate and compose new music for diverse congregations, including a real eye on generational differences. Because a lot of things that are in our hymnals or in our repertoire right now for example, Hispanic and Latino congregations, millennial Latinos don't listen to and they don't want, and they don't know how to enter into them. So whether it's repurposing those things in their tradition or rewriting, but I mean, the demographics are showing 2024, 2040, every city is getting a different groups of people. Whatever happens with refugees overseas affects us. And we'd have to ask ourselves, are we willing as churches and musicians to develop resources that will help the church to be hospitable and to communicate hospitality in the way that we worship God, who is the one who modeled that for us? I think that resource is very needed, and I hope somebody who likes to do that does it.
There's an interesting resource that is absolutely needed, and it's called reconciliation. Now, check this out. If you look at the history of music, the very reason why we have rock and R&B is because of racism. And if you look at gospel music, you look at the various genres and spans of church music, there's a racial divide going right up the middle. And we are our best resource, and we're still afraid to reach across whatever line there is, because I haven't found it yet. But we're afraid to reach across the line and get to know one another and to share from intimate space. The Bible teaches us that where a meal is a very intimate space. But the Bible also shows that where music is also intimate space. And we've avoided these intimate spaces. And to Sandra's point is that the world is no longer watching TV in black and white TV. We have millions of pixels, right? We have Technicolor, right? And so the issue in terms of reconciliation is not a black-white thing. We have a gender challenge. We have other ethnicities and races who are being left out of the narrative. And there needs to be a holistic thing, because we talk about the global church, but we don't want to worship in there. We don't want to go in that room. We want to do in our room and have the global church come to us, right, that in a way that's aesthetically pleasing so I can deal with the global church. Right? But we don't want to go to the global church because that's, right? So I think music is a representation of where we are. And the more homogenous that we are in our musical tastes are a reflection of the fact that we have not done the hard work of reconciliation.
Can I add to that? I think the comment I was making earlier about relationships, I think that's why while social media and all these like kind of easily accessible things are good, they're good to like tune our ears, help us practice, you know, musically alongside of a CD or get the sheet music for something. But you, in being in relationship with someone, like a young black youth in my community tells me what they need when they come on a Sunday morning to connect with and survive for a next week out on the street and in school. So if I'm not in relationship, then I can pick a song I think sounds cool or has like connects with me or my voice sounds really good on it, which is how we usually pick songs. Or I can say to that person, what is connecting with you right now? And that's why I'm constantly emailing. Hillsong's Passion puts out a new CD. I email to 15 Asian American second gen. I know that's what they're gonna play. My question is, which songs on that CD are resonating with the journey of the Asian American second generation? Because there's a theme that comes out very strongly. And I could just say, oh, let me just pick a song from that list. So I think the relationships allow us to enter into the narrative of somebody who will likely, for some of our communities, be the majority of the growing Pentecostal and evangelical church expression.
I think on that theme, I read a book by Ta-Nehisi Coates called Between the World and Me. It's a New York bestseller. I was extremely grieved as I read that book because I just realized that he has not engaged with a church that is preaching a gospel to the brokenness that he's talking about. And so one thing I think a resource that we need is we need resources. We need Christians that are engaging with that level of brokenness. I don't know if the book has been written yet or what the equivalent of it is, but you know, I remember talking to a friend of mine named Alfredo, and when he was 18 years old, he walked across the border and he worked 2 years as indentured servant from 18 to 20. I was in college at that time. And I was like, man, I didn't know people were still working as slave workers, like, and that really still happened today. Until he entered my life, that has not been part of my worship experience or my ethos of how I practice. But as I've been reading the scriptures since my relationship with him, I see how God puts that burden on showing hospitality to foreigners, people who aren't from wherever we're from. And so I think that's a big resource. I mean, I think having these conversations, reading these type of books, and seeing the brokenness in the world is really, really key. I don't know if we're really engaging into that level. We got a lot of vertical worship, but we don't have a lot of horizontal things. From a practical side, a resource, I just think there's a lot of, I would love for somebody to create a resource. There are a lot of independent artists. Like I think the way of the music industry is going. It's just with the web and with things like Bandcamp and all types of stuff. the power of the industry is waning. And so I feel like we need a curation of independent artists that we kind of know, like we can do this type of thing, and somehow there's, I mean, I feel like Cardiffonia is resourcing certain stuff, but that's just like one resource. And I mean, all the things that we talked about, I didn't know any about this. If we weren't in this room, I wouldn't have known, but I would love for like an online resource, just like Praise Charge or CCLI or something like that, either for them to expand, to include this, which I doubt would ever really happen. So that I feel like there needs to be like an alternative of some sort that helps to do that.
Speak to that really quick. I think, and this is really involves you all and us as you, as worship leaders too, but we need mature curation. And we need a curation that isn't tied to financial incentives.
Yeah.
We just do.
Amen.
There's nothing wrong with making money from making music, nothing at all. There's nothing wrong with having people that curate that and help make money from that too. But there's a structural system there that is going to homogenize a lot of things. And you see this. This is as much of a benefit as CCLI is. It puts out a top 25. It's done that for over 20 years now. That has shaped and sculpted the language, the theology, and the music of the American church. And some of that's been fine. But I think that there's a lot more room, there's a lot more work to be done that isn't financially incentivized in such a industrial fashion.
Yeah. I mean, I just think just hearing everybody talk and share, you need to be good pastors to your congregations.
Yes, yes, yes.
You know, whether it's in a multicultural setting or whether you're in a white suburban church. You need to love your people and try to just bring the richest, broadest, most revelation, heaven-filled expression of worship for your context. And this is why we're gathered together, pack out this room, trying to figure out how to do this better.
Absolutely, yeah. And I imagine that you all, this has probably stimulated more questions than we have time for, but with the remainder of our time, I would like to open the floor, and I'll come down with the microphone and kind of pass it down the row. If anybody has questions, I'd ask that you stand up and come to you. Questions for our panel. Yes.
Hi, Baylor student. I have a question, like, in a church with limited musical, I'm gonna use the word resources, maybe musicians that don't play up to a standard that you're perhaps used to, is what I'll say. How do we go about doing the songs that God has placed on our hearts in a context, I won't talk about, in a context where the musicians aren't as talented? Or do we go and seek out tracks or YouTube tutorials? I mean.
Yeah, so I definitely agree with what Emmett said. And I think you gotta have a place for people. I think one of the disadvantages of the contemporary movement has, a lot of them have gotten away with choir. And I think choir is the best place to train people how to be musical, you know? And I think that's I wish everybody would have a choir of some sort. It's also, it's its own small community group. It tends to be people care for people spiritually. It's just the nature of a band. You just can't do the same thing you can do with a choir. From an instrumental standpoint, people on our when I was leading worship as a worship, leader, worship pastor, I would have, I kind of rated people at A, B, C, D, and F. And if you were D and F, you would do something else, you know? But if you were like a C, and you could be part of the choir, or you could like participate in another thing that didn't require music. If you were like C, if you were an A level person, your responsibility was to help everybody else. Like, I mean, I will work with you, but I believe that you should be able to fire volunteers. It just is, and I would fire a volunteer fast off of bad attitude, you know? Like, and so that's one thing. And I think if you're one of the best musicians, then what your job is automatically is to help everybody else out. If you are a C or a B person, your other job is to continue to get better, you know, to get better at what you're doing. And what I feel like is really important, because I'm asking volunteers to sound professional, and I spent 20 plus years working on it. So I, in our budget, we would spend time investing in the people to help them with their musical skills. Like, at least after they get finished being with us a year, 2, 3 years later, they should be better as what they are and just give generously. And that's another thing I would do, even for the people who were A-level players. I would give them a couple of lessons with one of the best musicians in town. And it's just that kind of investment in the people pays dividends, because people know you care about them. It's not just about what you can get out of them. And so everybody on the worship team has the expectation of, one, knowing their music ahead of time, two, working on their musicianship, whatever that case is. And the baseline thing is everybody's going to have a good attitude, a servant heart attitude.
Go ahead, Sandra.
To quote a famous CCLI artist, I'll give you more than a song, because a song in itself is not what you have required. The majority church around the world, we would have to say either the majority church around the world doesn't have good worship, or we have a perverted idea of what good worship is. Because if you've had an opportunity to congregate with brothers and sisters around the world who have no overhead, and you walk into that place, and that place is like bumping. I mean, people are worshiping God, they're celebrating, they're lamenting for 3 hours, and they're having good worship. And I think there's something beautiful in the simplicity of the congregation singing. And I think we have to find ways to do that. So practically speaking, I would say you choose songs that work for your band and your team and your congregation. Like, there's such diversity in every expression of worship. I mean, I don't play an instrument. I'm a classically trained musician that does not play an instrument. And I lead gospel with a tambourine and my voice and the congregation. So I think we're worshiping. Yeah, I mean, like, plugged in instrument, that kind of, don't try to test me on that. But anyway, all I want to say is, I guess I want to reorient us a little bit. And I think actually what has happened in the music industry is very detrimental, not only to us here in the States, but I think what I would say, it's like a modern colonization of worship and theology across the world. You go to places like Argentina and it's like, there are certain songs, and I don't think, I really wonder, I always ask myself, 100 years from now, is the next generation going to be asking of us in worship and theology what we ask of the early missions movement? Or are we going to allow and champion the movement of worship around the world to influence us in mutuality as we receive, as the ones who are at the center of power right now?
I think to build off of that too, in worship ministries I've been involved with, we used to be in a culture that people would get together and sing and do music all the time, right? And I find now, you know, I'm like, okay, if I can get like an hour with my worship team here or an hour here, it's just not enough time, you know, to really like give space and give a relaxed atmosphere for your musicians to grow musically. And so I just started doing something where every quarter I would get all my musicians together for a potluck, and we would just eat and we would just jam. And, you know, it was amazing over a span of a year how musicians improved, where I hadn't seen that kind of improvement over years, of them just coming to that like 1 or 2 hour rehearsal where they're stressed and they know where they're at musically. And so they just need some more kind of just laid back opportunities to just play and practice and just jam.
Your gift cannot be held hostage by the lack of resources in the space. So my immediate response to you is find somebody who can play what you need, record it and have it on your phone, so that you can travel with it, because your gift cannot be held hostage by the lack of resources in the space. And then also, we are being penalized because of the bad fiscal decisions of our parents and grandparents' generation, who didn't find this aspect to be something to invest in before. So again, we have to understand that there was a different distribution of resources and funds in previous generations, to the point that we were not prepared for where we are now. So I go back to the fact that your gift, and there are some phenomenal singers, vocalists, psalmists, minstrels, minstrelesses, et cetera, who have been gifted in that space. And we should not be forced to water down our giftedness because of a lack of resources or a lack of references there. So that the goal is, as a stopgap measure, is when you do find somebody who is able to do that accompaniment, it becomes your own personal track that you roll with, in essence, on your phone, right? And when you are asked to sing and offer a selection, whether it's a sermonic selection or invitation selection, whatever it is, you do exactly what some of us did up here. You have somebody hold your phone, push play, and hold it right here, right? So that you can minister, because we have an imbalance in our churches, and too many people are suffering to the point that we have some very talented musicians who are trained musicians who refuse to play in the church now because our churches are nickeling and diming folks, right? Our churches are not reinvesting in folks. So we pray for our children to go to college and receive an education. And some of our children go to a music school and receive a musical education, but then they come back and the church doesn't want to invest in a career track or a career path for them, such that they have to go do something else other than what the Lord had called them to do. So we cannot be held hostage to the lack of resources, or what I would call the misdistribution of resources in these local parishes. I pray that we will catch up to where we are and then move ahead so that we can be prepared for the next season, but you cannot allow your gift to be held hostage.
Other questions? I saw this hand.
I think many of us mourn the stratification around the terms contemporary and traditional. And I was wondering if somebody would speak to the need for revitalization of the choral tradition in our churches.
Yeah, I'll definitely jump on that. Did you hear your laughter? Did you feel the beauty of what it means to be in solidarity with somebody you don't know, but you've allowed yourself to make a joyful noise unto the Lord? It didn't say a beautiful, pretty noise. It said a joyful noise. And just off the question, we had a cacophony that was beautiful in the spirit, because we all joined in solidarity to so yes, we need more choral music. And the tension is, we need folks who are trained in order to teach and conduct and to direct and to curate choral music, but we also need spaces in our local congregations and parishes for that to occur, because that becomes another meeting, right? Meeting place where we gather together and work through repertoire, but it also is a commitment. And as you find the commitment to small groups and family groups and care groups, you find this coinciding at the same time where you have us moving down the choirs and whatnot, because you need space to do these things. I think we need local church choirs. I think we need community choirs. I think we need regional choirs, perhaps amongst your denominations or some brother and or sister churches to get together and do maybe some seasonal stuff. But there's nothing more beautiful. You talk about relationship. You build a very intimate relationship when you sing in a choral situation, because the whole point is that individual voices become a part of a collective. And if you have 10 sopranos, you don't want to hear one of those soprano voices. You want to hear the power of the 10 uniting. And so I think we need to get back there. Again, it's going to take some resources. It's going to take some space. And then the praise team or the worship band, they're going to have to come up with one of them Sundays too, right? So that the choir can sing, right? And so you have these different tensions, but I think it's important. And the other piece is this. I would hate to be a part of the generation that killed off something. You see what I'm going at? I'm going to just leave that there. Yeah.
I mean, pick it back up. I used to be a music teacher, and I went down to elementary school, and the kids did not know how to sing. Like, I mean, it's just not a thing. And so I think it's becoming a dying art form, and it really, really should be. I'm not a singer, but I really, really believe in the power of choir. It's also been a really great way within our community to, by default, being educated, being economically mobile. When you're sitting across eating a meal together with a homeless brother or sister, or somebody who is economically unstable, it's hard to not have that power dynamic there when I could just go and go to a restaurant at any point. What we found is that the choir ended up being the neutralizer, because it was a medium that has just had really, really helped our community come together, where people who, where money didn't matter, how much money you had didn't matter, and what you could contribute to the community, and it's been really, really great.
Maybe as a caveat, though, if we're interested in revitalizing the choir in the church, I, as a pastor who have been in churches where choirs have done major damage to the worship service and have, forgive me, they brought in idols, just like modern worship performancism has brought in idols into the sanctuary. And one of the things I'd want to say is, if we're going to be interested in revitalizing the choral tradition, one of the things that we need to be pastorally aware of and guardians of is the sacredness of the communal experience of corporate worship. And what I mean by that is, I don't know that the worship service itself is supposed to bear the full burden of revitalizing the choral tradition. And we really need outside spaces for community choirs and for choirs to perform, because the flip side is, the more opportunities you provide for special music to occur in your worship service, the more you're taking away the whole voice of everybody. And so what I think is important is for pastoral figures to encourage choirs to understand their number one role is always to equip the communal singing of the body of Christ, and to mirror it, to do it excellently as a way of encouraging all that, but to kind of never get to that place where we must preserve the machine of the performance of the choir. And I'm very sensitive to this because I've been in environments where that's just taken over and it's been a beast and it's done horrible things to the local church, and it's killed spirits and it's divided people. And so that would be the caveat that I have, and I hear it in people who call for the revival, and I'm all for it, but I hear it in people who call for it. It comes from a place of hurt because it's been so marginalized lately. And I guess I'd say pastoral sensitivity at the front end of being able to deal with that is tantamount for it to be done well and rightly and appropriately.
And I don't think
it's necessarily disagreeing with anybody, yeah. But it's just a big check in my spirit from my own experience. Yeah.
I also realized we just had two cultural different conversations.
Totally, because totally.
Because like in the Baptist church,
yep.
The choir is the congregational
right.
singing, and it's yep, not yep, the yep. anthem thing, you know what I mean? So yeah. It's, I mean, and so also what I'm also
right.
realizing, picking up, I'm not just saying only music that you read. Yeah. There's something special with doing music through rote. You know, and what's happening in that space.
Yeah.
And so I just wanted to kind of.
That's good. I was answering what I was interpreting was his.
And I interpreted. I interpreted through my lenses.
Right. Right.
So I just wanted to make sure that we had.
That's good. That's a good point.
Excellent. We've got time for one more question.
My question is: how do you incorporate or introduce contemporary worship to a really, 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 really traditional church? I'm the director of worship and arts at traditional. What comes before traditional? Is there something early? Yes, prehistoric worship. So now the pastor, it's a multicultural church, and the pastor wants to incorporate, you know, he has the drums, the tambourines, and you have 70-year-olds that's like, I'm not touching that, because they went through worship their whole life with just, I'm sorry, dear, I'm so sorry. So it's a thing where they just want to sing their opening hymn, their middle hymn, their closing hymn, and go home. So then I'll say, well, hey, let's sing How Great Is Our God instead of How Great Thou Art. And they're like, well, why? This is how we've always done it. So my concern is, I'm trying to sneak songs in slowly but surely, but I just, where the pastor's trying to go with his vision, that's my struggle. You have 70-year-olds and then seven. There's not really a huge number of in between.
This is a topic that books are written on and that we teach in seminaries for entire semesters. And my first response is always very slowly and very strategically, right? you want to value your 70-year-olds because many churches don't have them. And so a 70-year-old person, 80-year-octogenarian, a 90-year-old person is extremely valuable resource to the body. And you want to privilege and utilize that individual the same way that a 7-year-old, an 8-year-old, 9-year-old is. So what you may want to do is incorporate some of your contemporary stuff before the service and after the service, as people are coming in and as people are leaving, right? Because then it gives a very interesting dynamic that you can see what happens on the outside. And then if you have special days, then you may want to incorporate something, you know, but you want to do it very slowly. Very slowly. Because, I mean, if you think about it, what is considered traditional or pre-traditional, as you called it, was contemporary at one point. Yeah, I'm not going to say prehistoric, but, but it was contemporary at one point, and it became tradition, right? And so to somebody relative to time on the planet, it may be contemporary for them as a reference point. So you don't want to do this. Right, you kind of want to do this, just kind of.
And it can be tokenism, but a great way to introduce new music is to have a youth Sunday, or to have the children introduce it, right? Because no matter what age, they're gonna enjoy it and see it just a slightly different way. We had a thing where every fifth Sunday, the youth would introduce some new music, and that was kind of a slow and steady way for us to make headways in a traditional setting.
You have an overlay in your question of both culture and age, intergenerational, and that's a very, very, like, if it's multicultural and it's intergenerational and it's socioeconomically diverse, there are lots of factors there. And I think that one of the reasons I wrote specifically to creating culture change in a book on multi-ethnic worship was because I often feel like people assume people are scared of change, but I actually think people are open to change. They're scared of the way change comes to them. And I once led a worship conference for women in a denomination, and I was told, we've seen what you did at these other conferences, don't do that. Like, these are 55-year-old women and up, and they don't want change, and it's 90% white and only 10% black, and they don't want change. And I was like, then you can hire someone else, because that's exactly what I said. You can hire someone else, because this is what I do. And I think that if we pastor people, and if we value people, and if we value and all expressions and traditions equally, people will, and this 90-year-old, actually she was almost 100. She said, I'm gonna turn 100, you know, and she was like, and she, my friend and I were on the ground, we were so tired, Melissa, the one who wrote that song, and she said, I have never experienced God in worship the way I experienced this week at this conference. I just wanna thank you young ladies for doing what you did. And I thought, okay, you know, that was worth all the difficult conversations here. And I think what people need to hear, it's not only slowly, but respectfully. People are afraid that what you're saying is out with the old, in with the new, whatever that new is. And people need to know that we stand on the shoulders and the experiences and the journeys of the people who came before. So any way you can do that in the sermons, in the teachings, in the trainings to support the actual worship change, I think that that's important.
Yeah, I would encourage you. It sounds like there's a lot of pastoral work that needs to continue to be done, and your pastor also has to be part of the pastoral work that needs to be done. And I think a lot of pastoral work, and this is challenging for those of us who are communicators or charismatic leaders, I think this is, if you're an introvert, this is a great secret weapon, and that's asking questions and listening. Like, people will tell you what you need to know in order to shepherd them where they need to go. And so I want to encourage you, before you do any song, like, the battle is really not won on Sunday. The battle is won over coffee and dinner and listening to their story. Where are you from? Tell me about your experiences outside the church. Tell me your experiences within the church. And you just humanize them. One of the things that I would always do before I would get any kind of, whenever I was new to any church that I got hired, I would get the list of all the people that were on the leadership committee, the personnel committee, and the stewardship committee, or any kind of major decision making. I promise you want to be friends with them before there's any situation that rises. I'm telling you, that would always, you never lose, and you need to be friends with people
before you start changing things, before you there's a problem that comes up. Because inevitably, those change and problems are two things I guarantee will happen in any organization.
Well, one of the advantages of being the first panel of the conference is that we've got plenty of time to continue this conversation over the course of this week. I would ask, please, let's express our gratefulness to these panelists. Calvin site for the online resource that was promised. Feel free to join some of these groups that you've seen today. And to dismiss us, to go to lunch, to the bookstore, to the things that we have next, I'm going to ask Emmett to close us.
Let us join our hearts together in prayer. Most holy God, we thank you for this time and certainly for your presence. We thank you for your promise that you would never leave us nor forsake. So as we wrestle with the mysteries of your gospel, even hear the mystery of worship, God, we thank you for your presence in the room. We thank you for turning over new stones and unraveling new leaves for us, God. And then we thank you, God, for our commitment towards excellence. More important than excellence is to honor and glorify our God. So we thank you for the love and the compassion that has been felt here. Thank you for the commitment to justice and reconciliation that was spoken here. But most of all, we thank you for these, your servants, who are toiling in the trenches, that you may get all the glory, and that you would help us, God, to do this work in the way that is befitting of you, glorify you, honor you, and please you. This is our prayer. We pray it in the mighty name of Jesus with a spirit of gratitude. Amen.